He said, "Man, how do you listen to this stuff? It's really scary." And I said, "You know, I know the end, right? I know how this all ends."
He brought to my attention was the regathering of Israel. It's very possible that the end time scenario can be triggered because they are regathered into the land. That's one of the prerequisites for the second coming.
That's one thing I don't understand. The book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible that promises a blessing to those who read it. So why isn't it largely being studied? You know, it's the back of the book. It's the end of the story. It's Christ's victory. Why is this book so highly ignored?
Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. We'll go ahead and get started today. Hope everyone's doing well. We'll get started with our, obviously, absolutely nothing happened in the news this week, right? No, of course, we've all heard about it. We've all talked about it. The Supreme Court legalizes same-sex marriage. And we're not going to go down this tangent today. All I have to say about it this morning is we need to be in extensive prayer. We need to be praying through how we are going to, how we are going to express ourselves in these coming days with some of the issues. I mean, if you guys haven't already dealt with this issue, you soon will, just so you know. So it's just something for us to be really prayerfully considering how we're going to approach this, how we're going to discuss this in our places of business, in the shopping centers, etc. And just also, it's a good time for us to be in prayer as those of us who hold to a more traditional view are going to continue to be marginalized, as we've talked about, and ostracized by society. And it's important for us to remember that as the world gets more and more corrupt, that gives us a greater opportunity to be salt and light and to stop the decay as much as possible by just being a light. So anyway, so that's just something for us to be praying through, thinking about. A lot's been changing in the last few years. I'm sure that people have been saying that for a long time, but it just in the last 10 years of my life, I've never, it just seems like things are changing at a more rapid pace, which gets me excited. So, because we know Jesus is coming. As far as the economy goes, something's got to give. We've been doing a system, basically we're using a fake monetary system where we continue to pump monopoly money into a system. Eventually, something's got to give. So, and that's, we'll see that come together. Once again, I see all these problems coming. Somebody's got to have an answer for a problem, right? Well, God does, but we're going to see somebody step onto the scene that's going to solve these economic problems, these world problems, these terrorist problems, these division problems, these rioting problems, and it'll be the Antichrist. So it's something to watch. We just see we know that the fiat money system, the fake monopoly system that we continue to pump, it doesn't work. It's not, so eventually, yeah, we're going to run into something. How that all plays out, that's what it's exciting to watch in as terms of prophecy. So last week we crossed the River Jordan and we looked at that Old Testament picture of crossing the Jordan as walking the sanctified life. We looked at the Leviticus warning on how to be sanctified. It was really cool for us to go all the way back to the beginning. Remember when the Israelites were getting ready to cross into the Promised Land and God literally warned them. He said, "Listen, you guys are getting ready to cross in this land. Let me tell you guys how to stay pure." He said, "Stick to my word, okay? Stick to the word of God. And make sure that you're not getting into clean or unclean things. Learn what's clean and what's unclean." That was the warning to the Israelites. And of course, they didn't. They didn't stick to God's word. And they didn't stick to the clean things. They began to mix with the world. And that's how they became unclean. So we found out from that warning that we as Christians today are called to test things. We are called to figure out what is clean versus unclean. The big fancy Greek word for finding out what is clean was dokimazo, which literally means to test these things, to try these things. We're gonna walk through these things in life, but we have to figure out what's clean versus unclean. And as we kind of talked about last week, we went through some specific areas of, you know, gray areas in the Christian life, from having a beer to What were some of the other messy things we talked about?
Sports.
So finding out what is clean and what is unclean to God, it's messy business, right? We get dirty doing that, but that's what the dokimazo is. So what we did was we got dirty last week. This sanctification process, guys, it's going to be a dirty process. And it's what we talked about. Getting cleaned up is going to be, it's going to be ups and it's going to be down, right? It's going to be hard. That's why I love the illustration when Jesus washes the disciples' feet over and over again. I think that's a picture of us walking in the sin-fallen world. As we figure out what's the will of God, it's going to be a messy process. And we always have Jesus there to wash us and keep us clean. Sanctification. We finally looked at the fact that sanctification means overcoming the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. We saw that in 1 John. We saw that he was alluding to the book of Genesis, really the original fall, when Adam and Eve saw that the food was good for eating. They lusted after that piece of fruit, and they ate it because they wanted to get wise. So they were overcome. They sinned, they fall, their nature became fallen, and that's what we inherit. So unfortunately for us, if we're trying to overcome all of these temptations, we can't do it on our own. We can't overcome these things. We can't sanctify ourselves, and that's why Jesus came, and he overcame the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And through what he did, when we submit to him, that's how we become sanctified, is because of his life and his righteousness. So that's kind of where we went. We'll just go ahead and pray, and we'll get started on our new lesson. We're going to fly through some stuff today and hopefully get done with application of Pergamos.
Father, we come to you today with just awe at how amazing your word is. We just want to thank you so much for leaving us such clear instructions on how to stay what you consider to be clean. We ask that you continue to put on our hearts the things that you would have for us, Father, lessons that you would have us learn. We ask that you open up our hearts now, Father, so we can soak in, some of the sweet things that you have in your word, Father, so we can become more fruitful stewards of what you would have us, Father. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. So as we just stated, we're still on the letter to Pergamos. Anybody who's new or joining, we're looking through the seven letters of the Church of Revelation that Jesus wrote. Pergamos was a church that became very worldly. They began to mix things of the world with their spiritual walk, and these are kind of the list. So basically the application, we spend the most time on application because we feel it's the most important. If Jesus wrote these seven letters to us, and he says, he who has an ear, we all have ears, we know that these letters were written specifically to us. So therefore, how do we apply what Jesus was saying to these churches at that time? So that's where we are, and we're at number six. We must beware false teachers within the church. We saw this when Jesus was warning the church at Pergamos, that he said, but there are some of you there, here, I think I bring it up here, but I have a few things against you, and this is written to that church at Pergamos. You have there those who hold that doctrine of Balaam. Notice the context, those red words I have there, it's those. Thus you also have those who hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. Repent, or else I will come to you quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. This is talking about some who had crept into the church and were teaching these false doctrines. So at this time, I would assume that the false doctrine wasn't the majority within the body yet. It was just beginning to creep in through false teachers, through false teachings, etc. So we got to be on the lookout for that. And what's amazing is both Peter and Jude give us explicit warnings about this, especially in the end times. We're just going to read through them real quick. But there were also false prophets among the people. And in the context that Peter's talking about was in the Old Testament times, that there were false prophets among the Israelites. Even as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring on themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their destructive ways, because of whom the way of truth will be blasphemed. It's amazing to think about. Peter here is describing circumstances that are going to happen in the churches, guys. Because of some people in the church who even take the name of Jesus Christ, the way of truth is going to be blasphemed. The way of Jesus Christ will be blasphemed. By covetousness, they will exploit you with deceptive words. So they're going to entice us with lust of the flesh, with lust of the eyes, with the pride of life. That's what we have to really be on alert. And especially here in America, that's a very tempting thing for us to all want. And don't get me wrong, I love comfort and I love nice things, but we got to be really on alert here in America because the covetousness is a way that false teachers can really drive us in. For a long time, their judgment has not been idle and their destruction does not slumber. But these false teachers, like natural brute beasts, here, Peter's really going to tell us how he feels about these guys in the church. They're made to be caught and destroyed. They speak evil of the things they do not understand and will utterly perish in their own corruption and receive the wages of unrighteousness, as those who count it pleasure to carouse in the daytime. They are spots and blemishes, carousing in their own deceptions while they feast with you. You guys understand this, in the first century church, they would commonly just have these communal feasts together. They would all eat, they would break bread, they would talk about scripture. Peter here is giving an allusion that these guys are in among you. They're feasting with you, they're drinking with you, they're breaking bread with you. They are spots and blemishes, carousing in their own deceptions while they feast with you, having eyes full of adultery and that cannot cease from sin, enticing unstable souls. They have a heart trained in covetous practices and are accused children. This is where it kind of ties directly into our lesson as well. They have forsaken the right way and gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. Think about that for a second. This ties in these false teachers with our teaching of Balaam. Balaam knew that what he was teaching these people or what he was leading these people was wrong. But why did he do it? He did it because he wanted to gain power. He wanted to gain money. And that should kind of give us a warning that there are people out there, you know, we don't have to name names or look at ministries or anything. It's just important for us to really be on the lookout. But this is a warning that's been for 2,000 years that within the body of Christ, there's going to be people who are leading people in destructive teaching, into false teachings, into wrong teachings, just because they see profit in it for themselves. And we see scripture talk about wolves among the sheep all the time, but isn't it amazing that Peter here is talking about they've gone astray, they've followed the way of Balaam. That once again, that ties us right back to Pergamos. But he was rebuked for his iniquity, a dumb donkey speaking with a man's voice, restrained the madness. I love it how we always bring the dumb donkey back into the story. Anyways, 2 Peter, for when they speak great swelling words of emptiness, they allure through the lusts of the flesh. So I just wanted you guys to see that. One of the ways that false teachers are going to really entice us into worldly things is they're going to make you want the lusts of the flesh, the lusts of the eyes, the pride of life. That's how they're going to entice us. Through lewdness. We see lewdness is unbridled lust, worthless, vile, evil, usually with a sexual connotative, but they get people to lust after things of this world. And once again, guys, what's our whole point of Pergamos? It's to be separate from the world, right? It's to be separate from the love of money. It's to be separate from the love of things. And we'll talk more about the love of wealth and power in a little bit, but it's just important for us, once again, to be aware of these things, especially in an age of deception that we live in. Jude also, who happens to be the brother of Jesus, gives us a warning. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith, which once for all delivered to the saints. For certain men have crept in unnoticed. Notice that, guys. That's how false teaching, false doctrine kind of starts, right? This way that the Israelites, how it all started was a false teaching would just kind of creep in through leadership usually, and then it would just kind of spread, right? So we got to watch out that these false doctrines don't creep in. Who long ago were marked out for this condemnation, ungodly men who turn the grace of our God into lewdness. So think about that. They turn the grace of God into, so you're saved, you can do whatever you want, or you're saved, so you guys deserve this. You're saved, so you should have all these things, etc. And they deny the Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Likewise, also these dreamers defile the flesh, reject authority, and speak evil of dignitaries. But these speak evil of whatever they do not know. We see kind of the same parallel between here and Peter. Woe to them, for they have gone the way of Cain. And once again, here's our tie back to Pergamos. They have run greedily in the error of Balaam for profit. So once again, just as Balaam did, he was leading people astray through lust of the flesh, through idolatry, through the pride of life, for money, for profit. And there will be people within the church today who will do that, and we need to be on watch for that. So once again, Jude has some not nice words to say about these guys, and then we'll just look at the bottom there. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken before by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how they told you there would be mockers in the last time who would walk according to their own ungodly lusts. This has been a problem throughout the last 2,000 years of church history, but it's important for us to realize that this way of Balaam, we should see a resurgence of it in the end times right before Jesus comes back. And I would argue that we are seeing ministries that focus on enticing people to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the world, etc. But it always has been a problem for the last 2,000 years. And once again, it's just important for us to discern, to be what's clean, what's unclean. And once again, I'm not ever saying that stuff in and of itself is wrong, like material possessions aren't wrong, money isn't wrong. But for some people, that can make them unclean because they have an unhealthy appetite for it, or they have they can't walk a sanctified life if all they're focusing on is money, wealth, power, etc. So we got to be careful when we say that everybody should be healthy, everybody should be wealthy, right? We got to be careful with that because some people, God doesn't want them to be wealthy, right? Some people, wealth is an idol. Some people, wealth is a stumbling block. So just once again, important for us to pray through it and watch. Next point, number 7. Church leadership will be held to great accountability in dealing with separation from the world. Once again, how did these doctrines of Pergamos or of Balaam creep into the church or creep into the Israelites? I guarantee you they were filtered down through leaders, right? And we saw that when we went back and looked at the era of Balaam. Look right here real quick, Numbers 25. This is after they had sinned in the wilderness. Now Israel remained in Acacia Grove, and the people began to commit harlotry with the women of Moab. They invited the people, and the people ate, and they bowed down to their gods. So they fell, right? They fell for this trap. They sinned. Notice what they said. What God says here. Then the Lord said to Moses, take all the leaders. Actually, the ISV version is the latest translation. It says, take all the leaders of the people and execute them in broad daylight for the Lord, so the Lord's burning anger may be withdrawn from Israel. You can kind of see an accountability that the leaders had over the congregation, so much so that God wanted all the leaders wiped out because they had allowed this deception to creep into all the people. Just so you guys know, the word elder, if you're ever researching the scriptures, you'll always see, read through the Old Testament, elders, the elders of the church, the elders of the Israelite times, they were always held in high esteem. They always kind of oversaw all the important decisions. They kind of oversaw the way things went down within the community of people, etc. So they're going to be super held to a really high accountability. The words for elder are used almost 200 times throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament. And it's important for us to remember the parable of the talents. For those who are given much, much is required, right? There's nothing more scary than God giving you his people, right? So think about some of these people that, or some of these leaders that have. So for instance, Pastor Block, this is a heavy weight. You guys got to realize God has entrusted him with a flock, right? And he will be held accountable to how he treats that flock. So what can we do to help? This is the crux of the matter, and we've already talked about it briefly, but we need to be in constant prayer for Pastor Block. We need to be in constant prayer for Brandon and for Johnny. Guys, Satan is going to attack them, right? You see it all the time in American churches. I saw Billy Graham's grandson this week was the talk of the town because he had fallen into adultery. We see big name Christian leaders that fall into temptation or fall into etc. because Satan is going to continue to attack those leaders. If he can attack those leaders, if he can bring false destruction into the congregation, then he's doing really good. So it's important for us to remember that church leadership will be held to great accountability, and we should do our part, right? And don't, once again, guys, we're all leaders in our own circles. God is putting accountability groups in our lives too. We're going to be held accountable to that. Remember, the parable of talents also shows some have one talent, some have five, some have 10. Just so you guys know, I don't take it lightly that I prepare lessons for you guys. For all of you guys sitting in this class, I will be held accountable for every single doctrine that I teach you. I will be held accountable for every scripture that I put up here, and I try to teach you what I believe it's saying through the Holy Spirit. I don't take that lightly, and I believe we will be held accountable for that. So we're all leaders in our own circles. It's just important for us to keep that in perspective. Number eight, God will judge his people by his word. Remember Pergamos, multiple times Jesus brought us back to the sword of his mouth, right? Which if you go and you read the scripture over and over again, it's talking about the word of God. The sword is the word. God will judge his people by his word. I call this slide, Houston, we have a problem. Okay, check this out. Now, this is from the Pew Forum, which this is a highly accredited. Anybody who's read statistics, I guarantee you've read some statistics from the Pew Forum. This is a literal interpretation of Scripture among mainline churches. So mainline churches is just what we would commonly call just your average everyday churchgoer. Okay, generally speaking for us, maybe they go to church once a week, maybe they go on Easter and Christmas, etc. But they're just kind of a mainline church, non-denominational, mainline, just your average everyday Christian. 22%, so one out of five believe that the Word of God is literally true, word for word. They literally believe that what we have is the Word of God to live by. Only one out of five mainline Christians believe that the Word of God is literal. And guys, just so you know, think about this. This stuff that we're dealing with the homosexuality issue, this doesn't just happen overnight, right? This isn't like we shouldn't just be shocked that, oh my gosh, how did this happen? This took years and years and years of degradation, I lost my train of thought. But degradation, like it took years, it snowballed to where we're at today, and it's not easy for us to narrow down the one reason why we're where we are, but I can promise you one reason why we are where we are is for far too long churches haven't believed that the Bible is the literal Word of God. So that's something for us to think about. And another thing, as I was reflecting while we're on the homosexual topic, another thing that I was thinking about, and I'm not looking to put blame on anybody. But one of the things that I was really soul-searching and thinking about is, you know, how has the church represented true biblical marriage? You know, unfortunately, a case could be made that the church hasn't represented biblical marriage. When I research stats and I see that, quote, Christians, the divorce rate, some statistics say the divorce rate is higher among Christians than it is among mainline people, than regular people. So how have we represented the love of Christ? And unfortunately, we haven't done the best. So it's no wonder that the world is looking for answers elsewhere. So anyways, I'm not saying all the blame falls on the church, but we salt and light, that's why we're here, right? So this sin problem is years and years and years and years of the church not being salt and light. So where does that come from? A big part of it is this right here, people not taking the Word of God as literal. Real quick, I'll read through a quote that kind of, or a little story that kind of moved me. The Christian Post recently published the findings of a Gallup poll designed to gauge Americans' opinion on the Bible. The findings reveal the utter chaos in our culture regarding the nature and authority of Scripture. Gallup's poll found that 28% of Americans believe that the Bible is the Word of God and should be taken literally, and yet nearly 50% believe that while the Bible is the inspired Word of God, while insisting that not all of its contents be taken literal, but rather as metaphors and allegories that allow for interpretation. You guys are going to see where this leads very soon. You're going to see where that leads. Allowing for interpretation seems to be key for our postmodern pluralistic society, as 58%, representing the majority of self-identifying Christians in America, accept that the Bible is the actual Word of God, but insist multiple interpretations are possible. How many times have you guys heard that? Well, that's your interpretation. I interpret it differently, right? Clearly, the prevailing belief in our culture is that while the Bible may be the inspired Word of God, it doesn't mean what it says. It's only authoritative as long as the reader is the final arbiter of what it actually means. How many times have we gone back to this? Isn't it amazing that we have created, in America especially, we have created God in our own image. We kind of dictate how God is, who he is, what he said. And that's what American culture is all about. The word of God means what I think it means, right? It's only authoritative as long as the reader is the final arbiter of what it actually means. Debates on scripture ultimately all come back to the issue of authority, and the major professing Christians in America have rejected the objective authority of the inerrant word of God and have replaced it with the authority of self. Such mass confusion is only possible as deviance is aided and abetted by Christian pastors who refuse to defend the inspiration, infallibility, and inerrancy of the Word of God. And guys, this is so true. And anybody who's researched where the Christian church has gone in the last 50 years as far as even preaching from the pulpit saying that the Word of God shouldn't be taken literal word for word, if you're not researching this stuff, you may not realize that it's even happening. But guys, it does happen. And it's scary. The inerrancy of Scripture is sacrificed in pursuit of so-called academic respectability. The authority of God's Word is explained away to make allowance for homosexuality, fornication, and other sins of personal convenience. Isn't that where we're at today? Because of we've allowed. If people really believed that the Word of God was literal, we wouldn't be in the spot where we're in right now, in a post-Christian society that we're living in. The result of this situation is reflected by this Gallup poll. Okay, such pandemic abandonment can only be the product of weak preaching that comes from the limpid pulpits. This guy's John MacArthur, by the way. He doesn't spare any words, right? He kind of just tells it as it is. But once again, guys, we need to thank God for Pastor Block, for people who will stand in there and not give weak preaching, right? Who will tell us the things, not just tickle our ears, right? It's good when he makes me uncomfortable, right? So such pandemic abandonment can only be the product of weak preaching that comes from the limpid pulpits of the American church. Pulpits where God's word is used and abused to suit the whimsical interpretations of preachers who lack an understanding of the innate profundity of truth. Is there any hope in the face of such statistics and ecclesiological failure? Indeed there is, but only as the scriptures are allowed to speak. The time has come in our day to apply the words of Charles Spurgeon. Notice in yellow there, the scriptures are allowed to speak. Guys, there's been times where I've gone to a church service and I've never even seen them open the Bible. I never even seen a scripture on the main screen. Guys, you gotta understand, nowadays some of these big mainstream churches, it's all
entertainment.
So Charles Spurgeon, he's kind of an old school preacher. I'm sure most of you in this room have heard of him, but he brought the hammer. I would have loved to have seen Charles speak in our time. He probably would be in jail, actually. The Word of God can take care of itself and will do so if we preach it and cease defending it. See you that lion. They have caged him for his preservation. Shut him behind iron bars to secure him from his foes. See how a band of armed men have gathered together to protect the lion. What a clatter they make with their swords and spears. These mighty men are intent upon defending a lion. O fools and slow of heart, open that door. Let the Lord of the forest come forth free. Who will dare to encounter him? What does he want with your guardian care? Let the pure gospel go forth in all of its lion-like majesty, and it will soon clear its way and ease itself of its adversaries. Imagine that being preached from the pulpit. But anyways, guys, think about this. The Word of God, I know this is a crazy thought, but God doesn't need us. Did you know that? It's kind of crazy. He allows us. He uses us. And one of the things you guys will see with me, a lot of my lessons, I always am putting slides and slides and slides of Scripture. What's amazing is just as you guys simply read the Scripture up here, the Holy Spirit is teaching you. He's guiding you. You don't even really, Scripture says you don't even really need a teacher, right? We're doing this to edify each other, to kind of learn from each other, learn from past experiences, applications, etc. But if we just let the Word of God speak, right, then that's where lives are transformed. And that's also amazing, and this is important for us to keep in context, especially in the era where we're going with this homosexuality issue, right? Why can't we let the Bible speak for itself, right? Why can't we guide people to the God of the Bible? And obviously, you know, they're going to have their opinion of whether or not God's word is true, but it's the Holy Spirit is going to open their minds and their hearts to those who are humble. So we just need to get back to the literal word of God and let God's word take care of it, right? Number 9, we must look to God for our physical and spiritual daily sustenance. We saw that Jesus in this letter to the Pergamos, he promised the overcomers their this hidden manna, right? This bread. Manna is a type of bread. And we looked at how bread is a picture of both physical and spiritual sustenance. We all say the Lord's Prayer, give us this day our daily bread. No doubt Jesus is alluding to the fact that God daily provides for our physical needs, right? He provides our food, our clothing, our shelter. That's our daily bread. But he also provides us spiritual bread, and that was what we looked at with this hidden manna. The spiritual bread, there's three aspects to spiritual bread. It could be looked at in salvation. We have the three phases of salvation: justification, sanctification, and glorification. All three typified with spiritual bread. So for instance, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. I come down, I give myself so that man can have life. The cross, when we take communion, that's a picture of Jesus dying for us. That's a picture of justification. He gave us that spiritual bread. So when we trust Jesus, we got that spiritual bread, that justification. Number 2 is that the sanctification, what we're talking about today, how do we become clean? That eating of that daily bread, that eating of the Word of God, that's our daily bread, being letting the Holy Spirit speak to us through the Word of God. And finally, we believe that the third aspect of glorification, we believe that the hidden manna actually points to the glorification, salvation, when we get to meet with Jesus. So I believe that this letter to Pergamos, I believe that the hidden manna is a picture of us getting to meet Jesus, the bread of life, at the rapture of the church, and that alludes to the glorification. So we need to, once again, long for that hidden manna. Guys, one of the things that one of the reasons why we are where we are in America is because believers aren't longing for the coming of their Messiah. They aren't longing for the coming of Jesus. The more that we get heavenly minded and the more that we long for Jesus to come, the more pure we'll live, the more we, contrary to what some people say, I am a pre-tribulational rapture believer, but that doesn't make me just say, oh, well, Jesus is going to get me out of here soon. You know, even though I pray it, even though I hope it, it makes me, when I realize that Jesus could take me at any second, it makes me live more pure, because I don't want to be doing something stupid when he takes me, right? And I also, I want to be about my Father's business until that second I'm taken out of here. Every single day we have an opportunity, as Chuck Misler says, to improve our report card, where we will be handed rewards based on our faithfulness to Jesus Christ. Every single day you have a chance to earn more spiritual rewards. And I know that's a touchy subject, and we don't focus on the rewards themselves. We always focus on serving Jesus, but we will be rewarded for it. And it's not necessarily bad to think about. Okay, we must acknowledge our acquittal. So, acquittal. So, guys, remember all the way here in Revelation 2, verse 17, he who has an ear. So this was once again the promise to the overcomers of Pergamos. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give some of the hidden manna to eat, which is what we just discussed, and I will give him a white stone, and on the stone a new name written, which no one knows except him who receives it. So guys, that white stone, we looked back at that Greek word. It was an acquittal idea. Back in the day in Greek culture, they would cast a white stone if you were found, if you were innocent, or they would cast a black stone if you were guilty. And then everybody would vote as far as these tribunals would vote. And if you had more white than black, you were acquitted, right? So Jesus is saying, I've acquitted you, right? You're set free. And we're going to look at some real quick aspects of that. We're set free from the penalty of sin, right? As far as the east is from the west. And I'm pretty sure that's pretty far, right? Pretty far. He has removed our transgressions from us. They're gone. They're remembered no more. They're wiped clean. They're white, right? Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are as like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. You guys will notice on your desk, I brought you guys presents today. They're supposed to be sparkling, white, precious gems, but some of them are a little whiter than others, but you can kind of get the idea. But that white, I want you guys to see that white in Scripture, over and over again, it represents purity. You're clean. Also, I want these, you know, you can ask my wife and T. Hood and Derek, I'm kind of a dork. I always collect little things, and I'm a pack rat, and I have weird memorabilia. So, like, this would be something I would just put in my office. Every once in a while, you can just glance up and you can remember. I put the little scripture verse on there, Revelation 2, verse 17, that according to Jesus, you guys, he's already cast the stone. He's already cast that white pebble. We're not guilty. Notice white in scripture, it always represents purity. We don't got to look at that, but all those things represent clean, purity. And such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified. I want you guys to understand this acquittal process, okay? Oh, did you want that white?
Well, the back, yeah.
You want that one? Yeah. You can take a picture of it. And really quick, all these white things, Jesus at the transfiguration, that represents Jesus being perfectly holy. Angels, all the angels have either accepted or rejected God, right? That's why we're where we are. They've already made their decision. So angels can't step away from God anymore. They've already had their chance of rebellion, and that's how we know one-third of them chose to go with Satan. The overcomer's garments are white. The 24 elders are white. Tribulation saints who accept Jesus are going to be clothed in white. The armies in heaven, when we come back with Jesus and we watch him destroy the enemies, I wish he would let me throw a sword around or something, but I don't think I can justify that from the scripture. Yeah, I think we get to be cheerleaders. And then finally, the great white throne, which once again, that great white throne represents the ultimate in purity. Guys, and when you study and we look at the great white throne is one of the most sobering studies ever. Because when you realize that somebody is going to stand before God at the great white throne, that's it. Whoever stands before God at the great white throne, you don't get to argue on your behalf. You don't get to say, well, God, but this, this, this. You're standing in front of the pure, holy God. There is no arguing from there. But anyways, we'll get to that in Revelation 20 here in about 5 years. I want you to understand justification. You were justified. This is a legal term. You guys can write this down, but some of the greatest sets of verses for understanding justification is found in Romans 3. 21 verse 26. Notice there, God being justified. And then I just want, oh, by the way, this is one of the greatest run-on sentences in the New Testament. Like, if you guys ever study Paul, unfortunately for us as believers, Paul writes to us. Okay, we're the church. All the letters that Paul wrote are specifically to us. They're called the epistles to the church. And unfortunately, we get the hardest guy to decipher. We get the hardest guy to understand. Anybody, if you haven't really like read Paul and broken down, I mean, listen to this run-on sentence. For there is no difference. I'm starting there kind of, from here down, you kind of see from there is no difference. This is all one sentence here. For there is no difference. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation or blood sacrifice by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness. Because in his forbearance, God had passed over the sins that were previously committed to demonstrate at the present time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. We could literally spend 6 months breaking down those sets of words. But what I want to go over today is that he might be just and justifier. Once again, it's important for us to really grasp this idea, guys. We serve a just God. The way the world wants you to think is they want you to think, can't we just all have love, right? Just love. Why can't God just let everybody into heaven, right? Why can't everybody, God is lovey, 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 right? But you have to understand that true love always will have an aspect of wrath. True love will always have an aspect of justice. Guys, if everybody got into heaven, nothing that we do on this earth really would matter, right? It would all be a big soap opera, right? What we do matters because of the cross. But I want you guys to see that God wanted to be he wanted to be just, because guys, we all know we long for justice, right? It's kind of a sense of irony today. You know when people like speed by you really fast, like just crazy, and you're like, man, just please let there be a cop up there. Just let him get him this one time, right? And it never happens. But as we were driving here today, I saw it happen today. So it's kind of a coincidence, but it did happen. But we long for justice, right? We see injustices in the world. You see someone raped or someone murders, and you long deep down inside. We have this inside of us, and it's from God that we know justice is real. And once again, that kind of shows you how the atheistic or the humanist mindset It doesn't work. They've suppressed this natural instinct within us that what we do matters. Atheists, they know that what we do matters, right? Because unfortunately, to an atheistic worldview, guys, if they're right, or if a secular humanist worldview is right, nothing matters. Do you guys get that? Like, nothing matters. And in fact, we won't even go there. But anyways, that he might be just and justifier. So God, and this is the beauty of the gospel, he had to be just, right? God solved the ultimate conundrum. How can I save mankind and yet do all the work, right? That's through Jesus Christ. And it's amazing. It's really amazing. There's no words to just, you could spend your whole life really studying this aspect of God being just and justifier, because it was through him and Christ at the plan. He all knew what was going to happen. He all knew we were going to mess up. He all knew where we were. It was all part of the plan. I wanted T. Hood real quick. There's a really good illustration. We've all heard this before probably, but I just wanted him to tell, there's a courtroom story that kind of illustrates this point.
You guys can use this to witness as well. If you imagine God's problem, he's got rebellious offspring and he has to save them somehow, some way, but only he can do it. So it's, you know, a good picture of this would be a perfect courtroom judge, okay? And that courtroom judge is wearing his courtroom robe and he's sitting there with the gavel, sitting at the judge's desk, okay? And the accused would be his own son that he fathered, right? So he's got his robe on, his son is sitting there guilty of speeding, and the fine is $300. So how do you plead? The judge has to ask his son, how do you plead? And the son has to say, if he's honest, guilty. I'm guilty. At that point, the sentence is issued. The sentence is $300. Are you willing to pay that fine? Can you pay that fine? So the son has to acknowledge, I don't have $300. What am I going to do? Right? I'm in a heap of trouble. What am I going to do? I can't pay $300 for that fine. And at that point, the father steps off of his bench, comes down, takes his robe off, okay, stands next to his son and says, son, will you let me pay it? I've got $300 right here. Will you let me pay the fine? Son says, yes. He has to say yes. He can't just say, dad, just pay it. Like, it's not one of those things, the father, he can't just force that payment. The son has to receive it. So he puts down the $300 to so he can step back up onto the bench. Son now has the payment, puts the robe back on, you know, acquitted. Okay, he paid the fine, I can let him go. He's now deemed justified by the law's standard. That's the picture, you know, of the just and the justifier right there.
Yeah, imagine if the father just said, well, he's my son, he's free, right? He's innocent. There's no justice in that, right? And that's a perfect illustration of what we're looking at. I wouldn't say perfect. It doesn't even kind of scratch the surface of what God the Father and God the Son did, but it just kind of gives you a rudimentary picture of that. So we must acknowledge our acquittal. And that's why I gave you guys those white stones. I gave some big ones, some little ones. I want you guys to remember that you've been acquitted. You've been made white. That pebble, you can set it somewhere. You can put it in your garden. You can put it on your wall, whatever. But we can acknowledge our acquittal. And next week, we're actually going to talk a little bit more about those stones. But I hope you guys enjoy your bright white stones. Derek, let's pray. We're late. Get us out of here.
Father, thank you for today. And thank you for this lesson and all that it has to teach us. Let us remember, as 1 Thessalonians 5:21 says, test all things and keep to that which is good, and let us be able to apply that even to the leadership and people we listen to, and, you know, let us teach and guide others with fear and trembling, knowing that we'll be held accountable to the circle of influence we have. And let us hold fast to your word, Father. Let us take it seriously. Let us never compromise it to be more palpable to the world. Let us take it for exactly what it's supposed to mean. And Father, let us always look to you for our daily sustenance of both spiritual and physical bread. And thank you for that white stone of acquittal you've given us to those who overcome. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.